Just Say Sports on BCTV is supported by Strosstown Rod and Gun Club.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Just Say Sports. My name is Rob Gautier. With me again, the usual suspect, Chris Bardo.
Rob, great to see you.
Great to see you. Mm-hmm. We got a lot of this is literally the idiot edition of Just Say Sports, because since we've been on, so many idiots are stepping up to the forefront. You just don't know who the bigger idiot is in the sports world right now.
We were due to celebrate these losers.
And I was telling you beforehand, it just kept reminding me all month of the movie Wedding Crashers, with the end scene with Will Ferrell talking about the hang gliding accident. He goes, "What an idiot." Anytime somebody does something right now, it seems like it's an idiot. So, hey, let's start with our favorite idiot, Gabe Kapler.
Yes.
He's doing a tremendous bang-up job reinventing the game of baseball. Abner Doubleday certainly would be proud, because the two, you know, brightest men in the history of baseball, obviously, are Abner Doubleday, who invented the game, and Gabe Kapler, who's reinventing the game.
Oh, yeah.
Thankfully, as the Phillies manager. So we haven't really talked today. You said you've got some things to complain about. I've got some things to complain about. I'll let you go first.
Yeah, to say I have angst build up would be a major understatement.
And that's what we're here for.
Yeah.
To release the angst.
Rhys Hoskins continuing to hit second. Why? He's never hit second in his minor league career. He didn't hit second last year, and did pretty darn well in a third of his season, not batting second. He's struggling. No, let's let him keep hitting second, where he has to think about what he's doing and not just concentrate on driving the ball and hitting it hard. No, let me worry about working the count and the runner on first base here, and what should I be doing? No, no, no.
You know what, and that's a great one, because the ironic part about it is Rhys Hoskins was having a pretty darn good year until we moved him to the hole. So it wasn't like he wasn't hitting. Okay, let me try him in the two hole. It was like no one else is hitting well in the two hole. And didn't Kapler say something about the two holes like the most important spot in the lineup? The
Who
first
knows?
Person in the history of baseball to ever consider the two hole the most important
spot.
You know, the spot that Mickey Morandini hit in.
Mm-hmm.
Is now the most important spot in baseball. Let's take Rhys Hoskins and put him in there. That's a great one.
Oh, so frustrating. Your turn.
My turn. How about the positioning of players? And there was a lot made of it with Jake Arrieta and stuff. Let me just explain something to Gabe Kapler. When shifts came into baseball, they did it for hitters like Ryan Howard, who had no clue how to beat a shift or had no interest in even trying to defeat a shift.
Yes.
So now he's trying to shift based on numbers because, you know, JT Snow hits 80% of his balls to the right side. I'm going to put three infielders to the right side. Yeah, you know, these hitters are professional hitters. They see one, they could just stick out their bat, and that's what they're doing.
But only if they have at least 150 pieces of data, then they will imply the shift.
I forgot about the data.
Yeah.
I forgot, because no one else is shifting on these players. There's zero data to say that the shift works on this player.
And you know what else that's doing? Making the defense bad. Guys aren't used to playing in shallow right field. This isn't softball. They're not used to reaching out to touch second base, let alone wondering if they cover second base this play or if not, or trying to beat the guy to third base who's on second, and there's nobody there.
Does it look like Little League Baseball in that? It's twice that's happened now, where a base runner looks, there's no one in front of him third base, and he just thinks, I mean, that is Little League baseball. And this is a Major League team, Gabe. Major League team. Just trying to fill you in there. Hey, I'll give you another shot. This is an idiot edition, by the way, of Just Say Sports. Right now, our topic is Gabe Kapler.
Yeah,
doing a bang up.
And our number is 610-378-0426 if you would like to help us celebrate idiots. I'm going to digress for a second. Right before we went on the air, I saw the playing of Mitch Williams. If this is not the anti-1993 Phillies, I don't know what is. Okay, let's move on. Thank goodness Franco is now officially done as the future of the Phillies at any point in time. Check mark. Bye-bye. Okay, next. four blown wins so far to this point in the year that will equal no playoffs for the Phillies this year. Opening day, the two Jake Arrieta blown wins, and the most recent one after Dylan Cousins hits the two-run homer to go ahead and they give up the slam to Hayward in the bottom of the ninth. Four already with 99 games to play that we can point to that say no playoffs.
But Adam Morgan's left-handed. And Jason Hayward's left-handed.
And Adam Morgan has a fastball that's straighter than an arrow.
Oh, my goodness. My goodness. That was a killer. And I am so thankful I went to bed before that because I wouldn't have slept all night.
Oh.
He just makes me so angry. Okay, how soon, now that we're still on the idiot, my turn, how soon to the best pitching relief prospect that the Phillies might have ever had blows out his arm?
Hopefully not too soon, but he's well on his way after the last 41 pitch outing that he's not ready for.
two innings, 41 pitches.
Yeah.
They paid $9 million for Tommy Hunter to pitch one of those innings. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't throw him in until there's already two outs in the ninth and he gets the save.
Yeah.
He pitches a perfect 1-2-3 inning against Chicago. And then he has to throw Sir Anthony back in there.
That's a great point you make.
And then the moment he gets a couple base runners on, let's yank him and put him in for Adam Morgan. And let's go back to that Chicago Cubs series because game one, the Phillies were up 6-1. And who's he pitching the ninth inning? Sir Anthony Dominguez. So he's not available for two innings the next night. Yeah. And he tried it anyway. Gabe Kapler. Yeah. The guy, and the Phillies are paying how many millions of dollars for analytics? They've got all kinds of guys in
there. Yeah.
Hey, I saw the movie.
I think
Brad Pitt and Jonas Hill, they sat in a room and they did it together, just the two of them. They figured out all the analytics stuff. Go ahead, your turn.
Jake Arrieta and his explosion after the San Francisco debacle and the road trip debacle in general. How can anyone criticize him for that when he was the only guy on that roster with a pulse? It was horrendous, the lack of effort and emotion they showed on that trip. And thank you, Jake, for at least caring.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You bring a guy in for that veteran presence, that guy who's going to, you know, what's he supposed to do? You call people out is what you do.
Yeah. Guess what? We had a really good start this year. And what was that? Horrendous. So anybody that criticized Arrieta for that, I would love to debate you.
Okay, my turn. Phillies had a shortstop prospect who was at one point considered one of the top five prospects in all of baseball.
Is there his initials JP?
Might be JP Crawford, might not be.
Okay.
But let me digress a little bit. So JP Crawford hasn't developed as quickly as the Phillies would like him. Okay, and that's understandable. So now J.P. Crawford's back at the major league level. Let's put him at third base and put our future second baseman at shortstop. Not our future shortstop, at shortstop, where he's a shortstop.
Seems logical to me.
Kingery makes some good plays at short, but my God, how many, now, you see, I'm getting phone calls already on this phone. So, if you guys don't mind. Sid, could you turn on TV? We're on TV right now. Thanks. Just my daughter. But anyway, yeah.
Yeah, I don't get that either. It makes no sense. Like I said, I'm glad Franco's out of the picture, but why is Crawford at third?
I have no idea. Now, another thing. They've taken Franco. And they've done this whole launch angle. This is my new favorite term, launch angle. So they're promoting this launch angle, and it's supposed to give the team more home runs, and it increases the exit velocity.
Yes.
Launch angle and exit velocity. Okay?
Velo to some.
So we, so the Phillies have eight everyday players, let's say that. Please name one. One who's exceeded expectations.
Yeah, we briefly discussed this, and I'm still thinking at this point. And like I said, the only one I think close would be Jorge Alfaro, who's been dynamic defensively.
Defensively.
And I think has handled the pitching staff very well. For a true rookie. He hasn't hit with the power. His average is up to 250, which is great compared to the rest of the team.
This is a guy who has unbelievable power, but because we're working about launch angle and exit velocity, the amount of weak ground balls that were hit in that West Coast trip.
Oh, horrendous. Yeah.
But according to Gabe, they're squaring the ball up, squaring the bat up. I forget what terms he uses.
Mr. Positive is just that.
He's very
not
positive.
Not concerned at all.
Positivity.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, finally, let's just shift. We won't talk about Gabe Kapler anymore. Manny Machado, his name is now being circulated with the Phils, with Baltimore potentially trading. Do you trade a bundle of prospects at this point to try to get Manny Machado in and hoping that you can extend him long term, or do you just wait and try to get him at the end of the season?
I only do it if you can get the extension during the trade process. I wouldn't mortgage it for 2 months.
And there's no way Machado would do that.
Yeah. So
basically you're saying no.
Right.
Yeah.
How about you?
I mean, there were a few untouchables. Right now, I mean, if they mention Sixto Sanchez, you're done. Conversation's over.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because this is basically Sir Anthony Dominguez, a starter, Sir Anthony Dominguez.
Right.
You know, you don't give up a Sir Anthony Dominguez. You don't give up at this point Scott Kingery either, I don't think.
No, these guys are brand new rookies. Crawford, it's way too early to write him off.
Yeah. So I think you've got to surround. You can't take away the assets Machado you've got to surround players with. Okay, why don't we move over quickly to the NBA playoffs, because we had another idiot, and his name was J.R. Smith. Unbelievable that they almost pull off an upset game one, the Cavaliers. They missed the free throw. J.R. Smith gets the rebound, and instead of shooting it, just dribbles out the clock, and then has the gumption to say afterwards he didn't want to shoot because Kevin Durant was going to block it. Idiot.
Complete. And I was watching live when it happened and knew exactly what he thought as soon as he started to dribble toward center court. Amazing. And it's just good that he did say on Twitter that if it was going to happen, he was glad it was him because he can handle it. Isn't that nice for the rest of the Cavs? JR can handle it.
He can handle it. And idiot number two gets so upset that he punches a whiteboard and breaks his hand and is basically not the same player the rest of the series. So any chance that the Cavs had, which they really didn't have any after losing game one, they lose it. So just nonstop. But thank goodness the Sixers had their own idiots of the week.
Oh, yes.
Twittergate. Probably the most bizarre off-the-court story I can remember in my 52 years. Is there anything Philadelphia, at least related wise, that comes close to that?
No, other than arrests out of season or even in season, I don't think there's been anything really severe other than people being stupid. This takes stupid to an exponential level. Speechless almost.
So, okay. I still try to wrap my head around it. So Colangelo says he doesn't know anything about it. He doesn't know that all these Twitter accounts are out there. Yet the moment the Ringer calls and asks them about the two accounts, the other three are shut down within 20 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So you're trying to tell me within that 20 minutes, he just happened to have a conversation with his wife. You know what, honey? I got the strangest call. They're asking me about Twitter accounts and saying that he really did that within 20 minutes, just happened to be talking to his wife, and then his wife goes and shuts him down.
Yeah. Ironically, the two digits used for the profile or whatever happened to be in her phone number.
Yeah.
That was interesting.
And it just strange how she cleaned out her phone, reset her phone right before she had to hand it to investigators.
Yeah.
But Brian Colangelo says that he knew nothing about it.
No.
Should he have been fired?
Oh, absolutely.
Well, according to Dad Jerry, another idiot in this idiot edition of Just Say Sports, said he shouldn't be fired.
Yeah.
He should keep his job, even though he's lost the trust of every agent, every player, basically the entire fan base.
Mm-hmm.
This is a blessing in disguise, this whole thing.
I agree.
I remember, yes. I was listening to one of the WIP hosts, and he was saying how this was an absolute disaster. There was nothing good about this. This guy basically made two big moves. He signed Jared Bayless for 3 years, and they're already trying to get rid of that contract. Mm-hmm. And he traded the number 3 pick and another lottery pick basically next year for Markelle Fultz.
Which through year one has not worked out.
Which has not worked out at all.
Right.
At all. I mean,
not when you see what Jason Tatum did.
Yeah. And I don't even think he would have drafted Jason Tatum. Now, to be honest, no. I think Danny Ainge was going to draft Jason Tatum no matter where he was. Mm-hmm. They figured someone would trade up for Markelle Fultz and so that can fall under the Brian Colangelo.
But I think it's the trainer's fault too, right? Markell's trainer or shooting coach or whatever.
Yeah, did you
he
see
threw
the
him
videos?
Under the bus.
Did you see the video?
I did not.
It's out now. This trainer has Markelle Fultz lying on the ground. He puts his knees over to one side, lying from that position, has him shooting shots at the basket. This is Markelle Fultz's trainer.
Oh my.
Yeah, that was a shoulder. You just watch it and it's painful because you know the shoulder's going to go eventually.
Well, that's simulating game conditions, right?
you just never know when you need to be laying down on the ground with your legs pointed to the right and you have to shoot at a basket make it. So, yeah, so I believe it was his trainer who actually screwed that up. Mm. And good news, though, is Markelle Fultz is working with Drew Hanlon right now, who is one of the best in the basketball world in terms of skill coaching, shooting, those kind of things. So at least Markelle Fultz is getting professional help and not going to his...
But is Herb McGee working with Ben Simmons?
Yeah, God. Well, we'll see. He needs to be able to get a jump shot. Continuing on our idiot edition of Just Say Sports, how about that T.O.? Idiot!
Exclamation point. It's almost speechless again. You're not going to go to the Hall of Fame ceremony.
Yeah.
Okay. Next.
Yeah, I don't get. This is his opportunity to. The one thing that Tio loves is attention.
Yeah.
This is his opportunity to stand in front of the world and basically, if he wants to, give him the middle finger.
Mm-hmm.
So instead, he's just going to not show up.
That'll show everybody.
People want to try to like this guy, and it's just impossible.
Yeah, I agree. It's.
I don't get it. He's an idiot.
Mind-numbing.
Mind-numbing is correct. Okay, let's touch on the NBA draft. Moving quickly through the day. I look at it, Sixers pick number 10. Mm-hmm. I look at it, this is pretty much, there's 9 players locked in. I'd be shocked if any of those top 9 are moved. So looking at it, the Sixers are going to have an opportunity at Lonnie, who came in for a workout, Miles Bridges, Colin Sexton, Shai Gilgeous-Alexander from Kentucky, Kevin Knox from Kentucky. Anybody there throw you?
Well, the obvious local interest with Lonnie, and he has, you know, clearly untapped potential. And is that what the Sixers need the next year, next 2 years? I'm not so sure. but that's certainly an interesting angle. And I told you last week, I think one mock draft I saw had him going to the Sixers. So I don't know. What do you think?
I'm always intrigued. I'm always intrigued because I really wanted to see what Lonnie could have done with coaching this past year.
Mm-hmm.
I still say Miami was the wrong choice. I don't know how much time he would have ended with Villanova because they obviously love Dante DiVincenzo and you could see why.
Yeah.
But should he have gone to Kentucky? Because the one thing at least Calipari does is make you play defense. You know, you're not going to get on the court if you're not giving 100% at Kentucky.
Yeah, no doubt about it.
So you're basically, and Bellani coming out was the absolute, and I said it when it happened, he had to get out. He had to come out now. His stock, unless he went somewhere else in college, wasn't going to get higher because mm-hmm. I didn't see him improving in that system, in that offense.
Right.
I wouldn't be surprised if the Sixers took him. I think... You can project the athleticism. He could be something special, but Timotei Luwawu-Cabarrot is a great athlete too.
Yeah,
and he could be another Timotei.
If he is selected by the Sixers, we need to keep our viewers' expectations in check a little bit. He's not going to start and average 20 points a game, so.
No. I think wherever
we obviously hope the best for him, wherever he ends up.
Yeah, and it would be interesting. It would be mm-hmm. interesting if he did get there. Push comes to shove. I think the Sixers end up drafting Miles Bridges. But it's interesting now because who Brian Colangelo thought, in his mind was going to be there and who he was going to draft now turns over to Brett Brown.
Mm-hmm.
And now Brett Brown looks at it. And do the Sixers consider trading out of that now? Because Brett has said he'd like an established player. If they think they can't get anyone in free agency, do they try to trade that pick and move
make it
out
part
of
a Kawhi Leonard deal?
Yeah,
possible.
So that's something to look at too, because Kawhi Leonard would be an absolute steal. And if Brett Brown's the one pulling the trigger, he has a great relationship with Kawhi. Do you give up the 10 pick and Saric and Markelle Fultz?
You would think Kawhi has a giant chip on his shoulder with a lot to prove right now.
Yeah, absolutely.
If he can stay healthy.
If he can stay healthy. U.S. Open this week, any predictions?
I'll take the field, not Tiger.
Remember you used to have to make that bet?
Yes.
Does Tiger make the cut?
I'll say yes.
Quite the optimist.
Yeah. His game certainly has improved. It's a long course. He's been hitting it far. If he can hit it straight enough.
That's the question.
And stay out of the rough, obviously. I'll say he does make the cut. What do you think?
I say he doesn't make the cut. I think he's going to struggle off the tee. Who wins it?
Dustin Johnson played pretty darn well yesterday, over the weekend. And
I think the course fits his game.
Yeah, he looks to be in pretty good form. That's who I'll pick.
Yeah. Dustin Johnson would be my one. I think Rory McIlroy's got a shot at winning it, too. Well, thanks a lot for being patient with us as we vented. We had 3 weeks of venting to do. My name's Rob Gautier for Chris Bardo. This was Just Say Sports, and we'll see you again in 2 weeks, I believe. Thank you very much.
Just Say Sports on BCTV is supported by Strauss Town Rod and Gun Club.